But you just talked before about the complexities of what we can and really can't handle realistically. Can we handle in our political structure, in our concepts, in our diplomacy, elements that Dr. Manocha just said, elements that have to do with people's deeper beliefs, deeper feelings? And if not, what do we do about it if it's really key to their motivations?
Well, I wouldn't be overly pessimistic, but I wouldn't say we're handling it particularly well. I think going back to graduate school in the early 1980s in Oxford, there were two concepts that really had very little traction at the time. I remember in our weekly seminars with Hedley Bull, the other former Australian professor. One of them was cosmopolitanism. Were we creating a global governance culture amongst elites, this cosmopolitan culture that transcended national boundaries, the sort of more traditional concepts of sovereignty, which are mostly represented still by our governments today? And were we nurturing that and building that? And the answer was, well, to some extent, yes. There was this common analogy of where my wife is with the World Economic Forum is part of that cosmopolitan culture, but it's also quite divorced from a lot of the human security that, say, child soldiers rescued from the Lord's Resistance Army in Gulu, Uganda, trying to be reintegrated back into that rural part of society, which I saw. That's a very different part of that human security dimension. That's how complex it is. So there is no one way to bring this all back together. The other concept that had no traction back many years ago, 30 years ago, was piracy, which we laughed at. You know, piracy is not going to be a big issue. What cosmopolitanism and piracy both have in common today is that we see that these forces that transcend national boundaries, either sub-state actors, transnational actors, or global actors, and global consciousness, are increasingly important in our world today. And actually, it's state sovereignty. It hasn't withered away, but it is increasingly challenged to deal with both traditional concepts of security, and Connie's right to say we're still very insecure despite the fact that we invest so much in security. But now we also are not prepared to deal with the adaptation at a human level, at a community, at a state level, to build the architecture for global governance, to deal with what a lot of people call the global commons, for instance. We live in a globalized society. We're very dependent on our internet. Well, that's cyber domain that we are dependent on. It depends on space. It depends on also maritime routes for our trade. All of those, who provides the public good of protecting those? Well, it still basically comes down to states, and that's why we have so much. Still, we're afraid to give that up, because give it up, what happens? Are we then even more insecure? So we cling to what we've had, because we don't know how to build the alternative, the bridge to the future. And I think what we've squandered some time in investing in the kind of global architecture of the future, hopefully that can take these values at a human level more to heart. And that's a long-term institutional capacity that we're talking about, basically Iraqi institutions. Now think about that globally for the global commons. It's a lifelong enterprise, and it goes on. It'll be passed on to generations if we're so fortunate as to still have generations able to live on this planet.